You can look at writing books and you'll often see detailed analysis of what makes a three-act structure and rising conflict and that type of thing. And then you'll see they'll include diagrams where it almost looks like a graph where the tension goes up, then comes back down. Then there's a setback, usually somehow in Act Two, when they think they've solved it. And then all of a sudden they get in a situation where it looks like all's lost. And then in Act Three, it gets resolved one way or the other. And you see this graph jumping up and down and things extended and arrows and all that type of thing. I wouldn't think of it that way. The best way to sort of understand these concepts is examples. And so I believe we gave the Wizard of Oz, tried to break that down. Most people know that story. And here are a few more. A couple from books, a couple from movies, the books that maybe made into movies. And I think the final one is The Sopranos, strictly written as a TV script. But again, you can learn from the structure. The Sopranos, we dwell on the very first episode of the series, the pilot episode. But, and you can judge for yourself how closely it may or may not follow that structure. But again, these are instructive. Examples are the best way to understand these concepts. And then you can make your own decisions, but use your own judgment. Okay. Three-act structure examples from relatively known pieces of fiction. Some of them have been made into movies. Some of them are strictly movies. The final one, I believe, is The Sopranos. But these are three or four examples. And where we've tried to kind of fit the plot into three acts and see how it breaks down. Jaws. Act one. A shark starts killing people in a resort town. The mayor is reluctant to close the beach and lose tourist business. And then a shark is caught and they think it's okay. But we, as the viewers, and I think that the sheriff, the main guy, I think that's Roy Scheider, we know it's not the right shark and we don't feel comfortable. And so the sheriff, Roy Scheider, in not believing it's safe, he keeps extra watch. He's concerned the whole time and he confirms the shark is still around and the shark nearly attacks his own son. And now it's getting personal. Now it is personal. That's the end of Act One, basically. Act Two. That's when you get the three guys in a boat. I think it's Richard Dreyfuss, Robert Shaw, and Roy Scheider. Tremendous scenes there. But three guys in the boat, and they start going shark hunting. But there's a lot of other stuff going on. There's male bonding. There's other tension that's brought up. They're telling stories. Robert Shaw almost perished. I think in the famous naval accident where sharks came, and they're very different. All three are very different people, but they start to bond, bobbing around out there in the middle of the ocean looking for this massive great white shark. Act three, the final battle. The shark, when it seems like all is lost, the shark is blown up. And two guys do survive. Robert Shaw perishes, and it ends with them kind of floating around back, hanging on to something, drifting. But they're going to make it back to shore, and they're going to live. And the shark is gone. A Simple Plan. Simple Plan, great book, pretty good movie as well. Act one, three friends find a plane that has crashed in the woods and it contains unmarked money. I think it takes place in Wisconsin or Minnesota in the winter. And I know these guys are hunting. I can't remember what they're doing, but they find a plane. They're just regular guys, simple guys, not rich by any means. And they don't know what to do. And they decide to take it. They don't all agree, but they finally decide we're going to take the money, keep the money. And then one thing leads to another, and then they have to kill an old guy on a snowmobile who's going to discover them. And so now you have these three people thrown into this thing, three ordinary citizens. They've had to kill a guy now. That's the end of Act One. Pretty good start. Pretty dramatic. Act two, there's fallout from the murder, rising tensions all over the place. Then they find out the money was ransom money and a fake FBI agent who's really one of the mobsters who lost the money in the plane crash, or was his money aboard the plane. He shows up as a fake FBI agent in their little town. And the third act, you know, a typical ending kind of gun battle erupts, gunfight. The two main characters survive, the two brothers. But in a terrible twist, one of them is forced to shoot the other to complete the cover-up. That was a tough ending, but a very compelling movie. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Act one begins. Butch and Sundance ride back to the hole in the wall. They're in charge of this gang, bunch of train robbers, basically, and there's dissension. And somebody else is trying to take over, and Butch has to kind of reassert himself by winning a knife fight and showing that he's still boss. Then they continue holding up trains, but this time it's gotten worse. They've developed a reputation, and there's a kind of a super posse now that, after this latest holdup, starts chasing them up into the mountains. They finally survive with a desperate jump off a cliff, and they decide to go to Bolivia, not do this stuff anymore. Act two, it shows them, I think somewhere down in Mexico, South America, where they have decided to go straight, and now they become payroll guards. But the payroll sooner or later gets hijacked, and they end up having to shoot a bunch of bad guys who are trying to steal the payroll. And they look at each other and think, geez, we went straight, but we end up killing a bunch of guys. The third act, the climax, they're pinned in Bolivia in a small village now by hundreds of armed soldiers in a tiny village, and they're trying to figure out how they can escape. And they probably don't, but there's still a final question that lingers, and it's very well handled in the story, because you're not quite sure, did they escape? So you come out of there kind of discussing it. Could they have made it out of there? Could they have ever escaped and made it back to Utah, where the hole in the wall was in the first place, and lived out their lives kind of anonymously? The final one, the pilot episode for The Sopranos. This is a little different because The Sopranos is obviously intended to be a continuing series, but you can apply that to your own novel, especially if you're thinking about writing the first in a series, where you don't slam the door on every storyline at the end. You want to introduce enough things. You want to resolve the most important issue in this episode, but you also want to establish character traits and underlying storylines for the future as well. So in Act 1 of the very first episode, Tony is introduced as the crime boss of New Jersey. And throughout the act, we see several different sides of him. And that makes it interesting. Obviously, on some level, he's trying to be a typical suburban dad, going to his daughter's soccer games and rooting on the sidelines and this and that, but he's also the head of the main crime syndicate in northern New Jersey. But we also see the introduction of the problems he's facing as a crime boss, and therefore, you know, all his supporting cast is pretty much introduced, all his henchmen, and you see who his right-hand man is and who might be trying to challenge him, but you basically see how the whole operation works and his key people. And there's internal conflict and external conflict. And you can relate to a lot of this as Tony deals with work and family both. He goes home and he's eating Special K with the kids in the nice suburban semi-mansion. But then he goes in and he does dirty work. There are multiple supporting characters, as I say, that are introduced in this opening act. And then the final part, I guess, sort of the inciting incident would be Tony collapses during a barbecue. And you wonder what that's all about. Is he healthy? Is he fit? Etc. And act one really ends there. And it turns out he's, you know, he's having anxiety attacks, panic attacks. And it's very hard. And then he starts going to a psychiatrist. Very hard to tell as a mafia boss to tell anyone about this because it shows weakness. So that's an interesting character flaw that they stick in there. It makes him even more compelling because he's very human. Act two, he suffered a setback after collapsing at the barbecue because our business takes a bit of a turn and his henchmen wonder, is he going to be able to come back? Is he going to be able to run it the right way? Is he weak? And so with his new limitation and mounting problems, Tony starts delegating tasks that he might have done, some of which he might have done himself, which expands the roles of his friends and family. There are numerous side stories now also that are introduced. And Act Three, one important part, just to add more layers to Tony and to really reveal his personality, we see him openly cheat on his wife, Carmela. And then a few scenes later, there he is telling her he will always be honest with her. So we learn what kind of flawed individual this guy is in more ways than one. But again, by the end of Act Three, all the storylines neatly wrap up. Meaning the main part, you know, he bounces back from the anxiety attack and he's dealing with it now in some sort of therapy. And also, you know, the side stories wrap up to an extent. But we're left now primed for more, primed for a whole series. So the first episode does work as a standalone, which I discussed earlier. If you write a series, you do, in my opinion, want each book to work as a standalone, where the reader doesn't have to have, you know, other knowledge to enjoy that episode. And they're satisfied at the end. This one, obviously, is the first in a series, this Tony episode. There's no prior knowledge they would have had, but they still feel, the viewer still feels satisfied at the end. They want more, but they weren't left with a cliffhanger where they're ticked off. So this third act captures Tony and how he feels about life at the moment, which is essentially that sometimes you have to make tough decisions, but in the end, you tend to go with the best solution available. You trust your gut. And we learn, you know, through, you know, things he's handled in this first episode that he's actually a very resourceful man and you want to find out more. Okay. So those are some loose examples of the three act structure.